Friends, thank you for being here on this very special day as we get to celebrate the life of Wilma and Peursem. As the family enters in here in a moment, I would ask that you would stand to your feet, and together we're going to sing one of Wilma's favorite hymns, hymn number 630, which will be up on the screens. There's also hymnals right at your feet. 630, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Would you stand as we sing this together? What a friend we have in Jesus. You may be seated. Family and friends and guests, grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And it's in moments like this where Jesus' words come alive to us as he reminds us all that if we are weary and heavy laden, we can go to him and he will take our burdens, that we may find rest in him, to take his yoke upon you and learn from him. For he is gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls there. That's the hope that we have today in Jesus Christ. This morning we gather here to praise God, to witness to our faith, and to give thanks for the life of Wilma. We come together in grief, acknowledging our loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow that we might find hope, and in death that we will find resurrection. Dying Christ destroyed our death. Rising Christ restores our life. In baptism, Wilma was sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked as Christ's own forever. What a joy we have in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Will you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. Lord God, with grateful hearts, with grateful gratitude that you are present in this place, that you are the one true living God. And Lord Jesus, we want to praise you this morning that Wilma knew you as her Lord and Savior, that she followed after you to the best of her abilities all the days of her life. And that, Lord Jesus, now she knows you in full completion as she stands with you in eternity. Lord God, today as we have gathered here, we gather not only with hope and, Lord, even with celebration for Wilma's gift of life to each and every one of us, but we also, Lord God, this morning celebrate hope in you. But Lord, our hearts are also grievous. Lord God, our bodies were never designed to handle this kind of loss. And yet, Lord, it's in these moments that we know that we have a desperate need of you. Would you shine upon us this morning and this day? Would you give a special grace and a comfort to the family? Lord God, we thank you for the opportunity to not only gather and worship today, you, the one true living God, but we also celebrate the fact that today is also a family reunion. That those that have traveled from far and wide have come not only to worship together as a family, but also to be able to love one another deeply as only family can do. And so, Lord God, we turn this service over to you. May you lead and guide us according to your will and not our own. In Jesus' powerful name, we pray. Amen and amen. Church family, as we continue to worship together, I would ask that you would stand again as we sing hymn number 772, When We All Get to Heaven. And as we sing those words, I want you to think about those powerful words of truth and what Wilma is encountering right now in eternity and what hope we can have one day when we too get to enter into heaven, when we get to hear those words, well done, good and faithful servant. Would you join me in standing as we sing that hymn together, When We All Get to Heaven? be seated. Are you shouting the victory this morning? Do you have a hope in Jesus Christ? I sure hope you know him today. If you do not, boy, you're going to get introduced to him today. And as we get to spend a little bit of time remembering and celebrating Wilma's life, Jerry has a few words that he wants to share this morning. And so we're going to let Jerry share a few things today. So, Jerry, where would you like to sit? Right here. All right. Come on down when you're ready.
Thank you, folks, for coming and taking time out of your busy days to help celebrate Wilma's going. I want to especially thank two young ladies that are serving our country in the armed forces. They're sitting right here. Would you mind standing for just a moment? Thank you. These are our great-granddaughters. Jordan is serving in the Army, and she's serving in the Houston, Texas area. Jessie is serving in the Air Force, and she's serving overseas in Italy, northern Italy, where all the action is. I wouldn't want to be where she is. But she can handle it. She can handle it. Thank you, ladies. Thank you for being here. Thank you. You know, this is a tough time. Tough for me. Tough for you. Because we miss Wilma. I miss her greatly. I really do. But you know what? This is also a happy time. It's a joyful time. Because we know that Wilma is home with our Lord. We can be joyful. We can be happy. We can laugh, which reminds me of a joke. You can laugh. There was this traveling salesman. He was making his calls for the day, and he made this one call, and this little boy said, "Hello." And he said, "Is this the Joneses?" "Yes, it is." "Well, can I speak to your mother, please?" "No." "Well, no, why not?" "Well, because she's busy." "Busy? Oh, okay. Well, is your father there?" "Yes, he's here." "Well, can I speak to your father, please?" "No, he's busy too." "Well, is there anybody else there I can speak to?" "Yeah, the fireman's here." "The fireman? Oh. Well, can I speak to the fireman, please?" "No, he's really busy, too." "Was there anybody else?" "Yeah, the policeman's here." "The policeman's here, too?" "Yeah." "Well, can I speak to the policeman?" "No, he's busy, too." "Well, what are they so busy doing?" "They're looking for me." We don't need to look for Wilma, because we know where she is. Amen. She's home with our Lord. Tough getting old. And I would like to think of the happy times, the joyful times. Forget the sad times. I miss Wilma. We all miss Wilma. But we need to be joyful because we know where she is. She's home with our Lord and Savior. You know, Wilma grew up in a Christian family. So did I. So did many of you. And you know, her family was instrumental in being the formed this church. There were four families, as I recall, and her family was one of them. In 1944, they formed this church, not this building, obviously, but this church. And this is the church that Wilma and I grew up in. We were members of this church. We love this church. We love the community. Now, I look around here. I recognize most of you, but that, you know what? There's a few people I do not recognize. And I thank you for coming. Thank you. You know, God's promise in Hebrews 13:5 says, I will never fail you. I will never abandon you. That was so assuring to me. There were times when I was God's caregiver, as well as caregiver, it was tough. It was really tough. If you've been a caregiver, you know what it's like. I was holding Wilma's hand when she passed away, home with the Lord. I didn't even know it. It was so quiet. It was 12:40 in the morning. For the last week or so, I'd slept on the recliner, thank you. A recliner for right beside Mom. I always had my hand on her arm. Quite often I'd put it beside her so I could feel her breathing. Because when I had my hand on her arm, I didn't know if she was breathing. I was just comforted. And she passed away at 40 after 12 on Sunday morning. And she went home with the Lord. She was so peaceful, so quiet. It's wonderful. Well, I got to tell you something else, too. The last thing I said to my wife, that she understood, is I said, I love you. And she said, bah, 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 bah. She couldn't speak anymore. But I knew what she said. She said, I love you too. Now, if there was family around or other people, she wouldn't say, I love you too. She would, what would she say, girls?
You better,
I hope. You better, yeah, right. I don't know, I think she loved me, but she would say, you better. You know, Wilma and I have been married for 65 years plus, and we were together in the good times and not the good times, but the Lord always walked us through, always took care of us. And true love is when married couples can stand together through the thick and the thin. That's true love. And Wilma and I had true love. We enjoyed seeing our family grow up. The girls got married, married great men, had great families, and they are God's gracious gift to us. Now I say us, I should say me now. Wilma's already home with our Lord. You know, this caregiving job, I didn't apply for this at all. I didn't like it either. But you know what? God gave me the grace, the ability, the energy to do it. Through the end, I don't know how I did it. I didn't do it by myself. The Lord did. That's all there is to it. I couldn't have done it by myself. It was tough the way it was. But the Lord took care of me. I was so thankful what the Lord did for me. Now, I didn't like that position, but I'm so glad I could do it. And if you are a caregiver, have been a caregiver, you know what it's like to see them through to the end, to watch them getting ready to go home to see their Lord. She was so wonderful. She was such a wonderful girl. I knew she had Alzheimer's 13 years earlier. I never told her. Wilma never knew she had Alzheimer's. Wilma and I cried together numerous times when she would say, I can't remember. But I didn't have the heart to tell her because she said, I hope when she would see somebody, our friends that had Alzheimer's, she would say, I hope I never get that. And I didn't have that heart to tell her, Wilma, you already have. She didn't need to know that. You know, I served my loved one who remembered less and less. And I was also serving my Lord when I was doing that, I felt. And he carried me through. And I believe we were exactly where we were in life because the Lord placed us there. I didn't agree with that, but that's what the Lord had in mind for me. So I'm dead wrong. If you don't agree with the Lord, you're wrong. And I was wrong. And a number of times I've been wrong. Anyway, every morning when we wake up, we have a decision to make. We can get up, look forward to the day, and thank the Lord for the things in our body that are still working and the things that aren't working quite as well. Or we can stay in bed and feel bad about the fact that we aren't doing what we would really like to be doing. And the Lord, but the Lord takes care of us no matter what. So when you get up in the morning, where are you going to be? You can be thankful for what you have? Yes, you will. I know you will. Wilma would want us to do that too. And she would thank the Lord for the parts that are not working so well. And she would thank the Lord for the parts that are working well. Wilma would like to know that she referred to death as a call. And she'd like to know that her work on here is done. She received this call, sort of an offer that you can't refuse, for an appointment from which she is not returning here. She's home with our Lord. But there's a huge sign up bonus. The bonus is the fact that she's home with the Lord, and she can see her family that are long gone, haven't seen for a long time. That's a great sign-in bonus for her. You and I will experience that someday too. People walk in out of our lives, but only true friends leave footprints in our life. And many of you, all of you, have left footprints in my life, and Wilma has really left footprints in my life and probably yours too. And I say thank you to Wilma for leaving footprints in my life. You know, when a servant like Wilma has gone, that means that you and I need to be stronger in our faith and be more witness to our Savior. So that's what she'd want us to be doing, be a witness to our Savior. Thank you for coming. God bless you, and God bless America.
Believe Rod and Mason were going to share a few thoughts, and so if both Rod and Mason would come forward, that'd be great.
Here, I'll give you the seat, buddy. It's going to be a minute. Hello, everybody. My name's Rod Rankin. For those of you who don't know or don't remember me, it's probably been about 30 years since I've been down here. I've changed quite a bit in that time. Just a quick rundown. I'm Nancy's son. And when my grandpa asked me if I would say a few words about my grandma, I said, oh, yeah, you bet, absolutely. And then I thought about it for a second. I thought, oh, man, I really love this lady. This might be kind of tough. But I'm going to give it my best shot. And I'm going to refer to her as my grandma, but she's also a lot of people's grandmas. And just a quick Cliff's Notes version for everybody here. We'll just give you a quick rundown for people who don't know. My grandpa had three daughters, Cheryl, Janelle, and my mom. There's 10 grandkids amongst those three. I'm not going to say their names. There's 20 great-grandkids, and there's also three great-great-grandkids. So you get a wow on the last one. All three of the great-great-grandkids came from the Rankin bloodline, so we typically start them pretty young on our side. Not me. When I think of my grandma, when I think about when someone passes, you think about little things, instances, food, a movie, something that will just you recall. And there are a few things that I wanted to share about my grandma that I can't think of without thinking of her. And they're simple. The first one, strawberries. One of my earliest memories of being alive is going and picking strawberries with my grandma. And it was my grandma, my mom, my Aunt Janelle, my Aunt Cheryl, my sister Amy, Jason, my cousin, and Deanne was there too. Bub, you and Ann weren't even a thought at that point. But I remember going and picking strawberries, and it was fun. It was, you'd get out early before it got too hot. My mom and my grandma and my aunt, they'd all work hard. They'd be on their hands and knees. Me and Jason would be jacking around. Then we'd get yelled at to go sit by our moms. Then we'd go sit by our moms, and they'd have a flat of strawberries, fresh strawberries being picked. And I was a little tiny, chubby kid, so I'd just sit down and start eating the strawberries. So then I would get yelled at then, too. So I think I recall that memory because there was no way for me to win that situation. Well, we had a blast. I'll never forget that. And then after we'd pick the strawberries, we'd go back to Grandpa Grandma's house, 8800 Inman Avenue. We'd clean all the strawberries. And that's when I learned some things from my grandma. One of the things I learned about strawberries is she used to make strawberry jam. And there's a big difference between jam and jelly. And for anybody who doesn't know, I'll give you the quick version. Somebody offers you jam and jelly at the same time, you politely say no to the jelly and you accept the jam. Because jam has the chunks, people are nodding their head, the chunks, the seeds, all the good stuff in it. Jelly's just gelatin with strawberry flavoring. When they're not looking, politely slide it off the table into the trash. My grandma used to make awesome strawberry jam. The one thing I remember alongside that, about the same time, I was probably 4 or 5 years old. I didn't like onions. About the only other thing I didn't like onions as much was celery. And the only thing they had in common is they weren't going in my mouth. And I remember my grandma used to grow what I thought was red celery. And I remember as a kid watching her one day cleaning it in the sink, asking her about this red celery. And she says, "No, Rodney, this is rhubarb." So that's kind of got a funny name to it. Whatever. And I don't want it. It looks like celery. And I trusted her. It's grandma. It was the coolest thing. I'll never forget it. She took a piece, cleaned it, dried it off, dipped it in sugar, and handed it to me. It's like, try it. Well, I trusted her, thinking it was going to taste like celery, and it didn't. It's kind of tart and kind of sweet. This is all right. It's awesome. So then from there, I figured out that you take those strawberries, grandma takes the rhubarb, combines them together, and makes strawberry rhubarb pie. To this day, it's still my favorite kind of pie. And I can't not eat strawberry rhubarb pie without thinking of my grandma. I eat plenty of strawberry rhubarb pie. So that's just something simple, strawberries. Another thing a lot of people probably don't know about my grandma is she was an excellent swimming instructor. She taught me how to swim. So everybody, most people in here have heard of our family cabin in Marcel, Minnesota, Pompeyama. It's got kind of a funny name, the backstory on that real quick. My grandpa's missionary buddy from overseas, went overseas, came back, and he gave these cabins all these kind of goofy names. For whatever reason, Pompeyama stuck, and we stayed with it after he took ownership of it. The funny part with that is there's two other cabins. They also have silly names, too, Umlaga and Hunderbun. But anyways, so we were at the cabin one day, and Jason's in this story. We're at the cabin one day, and Pompeyama's got two docks. They got the swimming dock side and the fishing dock side. Swimming dock side, Grandpa used to work his butt off meticulously with the rake, getting all the weeds, all the sticks, so it was a nice lake bed so you could walk into a sandy side. You wanted to swim on that side. This side was the fishing side. That's where all the boats were housed, all the weeds were, where big fish with teeth lived. That's where you fished. So one day, I was younger, and truth be told, Jason could already swim, and Jason wasn't afraid of fish. I was both. And that was one of the neat things about Grandma. She was down there with us, helping us. I was cool with putting a worm on my hook, no face, no teeth. I was okay with that, but I wasn't ready to touch a fish. It had eyes and teeth and stuff. She knew that, but she didn't embarrass me, didn't make fun of me. She also knew I couldn't swim, so she had to be down there on the dock. So we're fishing, you know, Jason, like a good cousin, catches a fish, knows I'm afraid of fish, pulls it up and kind of shoves it in my face. I start backing up. I run out of dock. My next step, poosh, into the water. On the fishing dock side, there's weeds. It's gross. I come up. My eyes are as big as saucers. Grandma hadn't moved an inch. All she said was, paddle and kick, paddle and kick. And so at this point, there's Mother Teresa and Grandma Van Peursem. I trusted her and loved her. So I paddled and kicked. Looked up again, then she said, reach for the dock. So I reached for the dock, jumped out, and I'm sure Jason was hysterically laughing at me. We're in the house of the Lord, I forgive you for that. And she said, hey, honey, you were swimming. I said, I was? Yeah, you were swimming. And I'll never forget it, because later on that day, we went over to the swimming dock side where you're supposed to swim, and we worked on it more. I went down the ladder and went away from the ladder and treaded water, and she helped me around the dock. And my grandma taught me to swim. I thought that was pretty cool. And so, total side note, I have three kids of my own. We went to the Foss Swim School in up in the Twin Cities, spent hundreds of dollars to learn how to swim. And I used to sit there and watch them with all these apparatuses and stuff with my kids. And I thought to myself, I learned how to swim because my buddy, my cousin, scared me with the fish, knocked me in the water. My grandma said paddle and kick, and I trusted her. I thought that was pretty cool. Something else makes me think of my grandma all the time are flowers, specifically red geraniums. My grandma had an awesome flower garden at her house in Cottage Grove. It was in front of the swing set. Then there was a big vegetable garden behind there. I think that's all of her roots from down here. And if you were ever outside with her by the flower garden, she'd tell you what all the flowers were. She'd walk you around, whatnot. It was pretty cool. She explained to me the difference between annuals and perennials. Annuals look pretty. They cost more. You got to replace them every year. Perennials, you put them in the ground once, let Mother Nature do her thing every season. That was really cool. And when they started spending more time at Papayama, Grandma started doing more with a lot of pots. And I just remember all the geraniums she always had. And I could never figure out how she could always keep them all, like, year round. And she explained to me again something she taught me. Is that if you cut them back in the fall before the frost, take them, put them in a dark place, let them go dormant, take them back out in the spring after frost, they'll do better and they'll get big and huge. And it was fantastic. And my Aunt Cheryl and my Aunt Janelle both are still green thumbs, which is really cool. My mom, who's sitting right here, is not. But she has the prettiest fake silk flowers you've ever seen in your life. Lastly, and this one's the nearest and dearest to my heart. You got to have an imagination to think of this one now, if you remember what I looked like 31 years ago, because my grandma used to cut my hair. And she used to cut my grandpa's hair, too. And you're 87? 88? You still got more hair than I do. But I remember my grandma used to cut my hair, and it was one of those times that you don't think about it till after it passes, that it was a special time where we got to talk and just share stories. And I used to remember my mom would say, your hair's looking shaggy, right? I'd say, I need a haircut. She'd say, call grandma. All right, I'll call grandma. Grandma, you cut my hair. Oh, yeah, sure. And it was never if, it was always when. And she was a smart lady, so she'd always tie them together. She'd do his and mine usually on the same day. And going back to those things that make you think of loved ones and stuff in the past, God, I can remember like it was yesterday. Drive up the driveway, 800 Inman Avenue, get out of the car, walk in, open the door, and then you hear the sound. You hear the sound of a hair clipper. It's a wall hair clipper, that buzzing sound. I can't think of that sound, and I won't for the rest of my life and not think of my grandma. It was so cool. So you'd hear that sound, walk in the house, walk around the corner of the kitchen, and here'd be grandma, there'd be grandpa sitting there. He'd have the mirror, critiquing how she's doing. She'd be trying her hardest to make sure it was perfect. I'd sit down at the counter, she'd finish up, and then it'd be my turn. Grandpa'd get up, he'd take off the cape, and it was old school. You couldn't wear a shirt. Remember that? Didn't have a shirt on. You're getting hair on your shirt. So I'd have to take off my shirt, show him that I was eating good. And then I'd get that, I'll never forget it, this purple cotton cape. And she'd take it, and she'd tie it around my neck. And this is the funny part. And she'd say, what are we doing today? And I don't know if she wanted me to feel like I was in a barber shop or she was a beautician, because up to this point, she'd only given one other man a haircut for the past 40 years, and it was the same way. So if you ever saw what I looked like from fifth grade to senior year in high school, it was my grandpa's haircut, only shorter on the sides, the back, and the top. It was hilarious. And I'd play along. I'd say, yeah, just short on the sides, back and on top. She'd say, okay. And she'd go around and get her clippers, get her guards on, and she'd start going. And that was the special time. Because we would just talk. We would talk. We'd catch up. He didn't think about it at the time. But it really means a lot to me, and it was a really special time. If Grandpa wasn't busy, he'd stick around. He'd ask questions. He'd start the conversation. I'd flap my gums, and Grandma would just sit there and go, uh-huh, yeah, uh-huh. She's focused. She's cutting my hair. But there are special times. One last quick story, and I promise I'm done. I couldn't say this if she was alive, but I can say it now that she's in heaven. When I was 13, my mom and dad made the decision to make me go to private school, not public school anymore, so they shipped me off to St. Agnes Catholic School. My dad's born and raised Catholic. My mom's born and raised Protestant, so on opposite ends of the Christianity spectrum, but at the end of the day, we're all going to the same place, worshiping the same guy, no big deal. But when you're in seventh grade and you're 13 and you get religion class and Catholicism shoved down your throat every day, you turn into like a 13-year-old missionary. And that's kind of what I thought I was one day when I went over to get a haircut at my grandma's house. And so, Grandpa, I don't know if you were around or not. Okay, all right, well, don't steal it. All right, so we're getting down. We go through the whole routines. How you want this, that? How's school? Oh, school's great, Grandma. I'm going to this new school. It's Catholic school. I really think being Catholic's great. I wasn't baptized yet at this point. I really think being Catholic's great. I think I want to be Catholic. Oh, really? Oh, yeah, great, great. So, yeah, they got, you know, this thing called purgatory. When you die, you go to purgatory, and you don't go to heaven right away. Then you go to heaven. And when she would cut my hair, she just, yeah, uh-huh, uh-huh. She'd turn the clipper off. Turn the clipper off. She set it on the counter. Say that again, Rodney. So, now I got her. Perfect. I said, well, when you die, you don't go right to heaven. You go to purgatory first. I don't believe that, Rodney. When you die, you go right to heaven. I said, no, Grandma, you don't get it. When you're Catholic, you die, your sin's not pure, it needs like a car wash, then you go to heaven. Then you go to heaven. Rodney, when you die, you go straight to heaven. Then she turned. And I thought, oh, man. And she just started. I was like, oh, it's going to be a really crummy half hour. So she goes and she picks the clipper up again. And then I hear that buzzing sound. Makes me think of my grandma. And she goes and all I hear is, zert. Oh, Rodney. Oh, Rodney. And then she shut the clipper off. Set the clipper down. I said, what? What? She couldn't speak. She hands me the mirror. Hands me the mirror. I turn and look. I got this poor old lady so worked up, she forgot to put the guard back on the clippers. All the way down to my scalp, up the side of my head. She's not a crier, I am. My eyes welled up with tears. She didn't know what to say. She just gave me a big hug and said, oh, honey, I'm so sorry. We'll fix it. We'll blend it in. And I said, I'm so sorry. I'll never talk to you about Christianity and purgatory ever again. So, bottom line, she's not with us anymore. I can say this. She tried to blend it in. It was the worst haircut I've ever had in my life. I was in seventh grade. I go to school the next day with a fresh haircut, and when I turned my head, it looked like I had surgery on my scalp. But, and it was funny. Up until she got really sick a couple of years ago, we would talk about that. That was kind of our little inside joke, and it was funny. One last thing. I was trying to think of a word to describe my grandma. Caring, loving, thoughtful, affectionate, all those things. And I think the word I thought of that best describes who she is as a soul is selfless. I think that lady, more than anything else, from the day she came onto this earth till the day she left it, was selfless. I think the Lord gave her a mission to be selfless and to do more for other people than you do for yourself. And I think she truly lived that out her entire life. Whether it was with me, with all the goofy stuff I had, from strawberries to swimming lessons to cutting my hair all the time, I don't know if I'll ever meet another selfless person like that again in my life. So I guess I just want to say, Grandma, I love you. I miss you a ton. And I'm still not completely sold on the concept of purgatory. But if there is one, you skipped it and you went straight to heaven. You ready, buddy? All right.
Hello, my name is Mason Elhart. I'm Grandma Van's great-grandson. Deanne and Matt are my parents, and Dave and Cheryl are my grandparents. I have a lot of fond memories of spending time with great-grandma Van. We enjoyed lots of time at their lake home and cabin called Pompeyama. I even had a couple birthday parties at the cabin, and all of us cousins have spent many hours fishing and swimming there, while Grandma and Grandpa watch from the bench swing on the shore. Our families would always put the docks in and out in the spring and fall. When it was done, she used to give us brownies that she made, and pop. In the few last years, she would still offer us brownies, but couldn't make them anymore. So we would just say, "It's okay, Grandma," and she'd go find us a cookie. I personally wasn't into stale cookies, but I'd still eat it anyway to make her happy. We also got to go to their Florida beach condo several times. Sometimes we drove the car down, and other times we flew down for some vacation time in the sun. Most recently, my brother and I got to go trick-or-treating from their Florida condo. We actually got to wear Halloween costumes without coat or hats. We didn't freeze, and everyone could actually see our costumes. We went to some high-end homes and got a lot of good candy. Grandma loved all the candy, even more than great-grandpa. She couldn't understand why we had so much candy. She'd ask us every day, "Where did we get so much candy?" One of my most recent and funniest memories was we played a game called Apples to Apples with Grandma. We went thrift store shopping with Grandma Cheryl and my mom while we were there in Florida. And I picked up this game called Apples to Apples. We thought it could be an easy game to teach Grandma. Who says you can't teach an old dog new tricks? And try teaching something new to a 86-year-old and a grandma with dementia. That's a different story. So to play the game, you get a bunch of cards with different pictures. You select a picture from your hand that most likely matches the topic of that round. The person with the best picture to match the event is the winner of that round. Grandma would pick some of the funniest or cutest pictures that didn't usually match the topic because they weren't usually correct. That made it crazy and more funny. But that was the best part about the whole game, and we laughed and laughed about her choices and that she enjoyed the game playing as much as we did. Me and our families miss spending time with great-grandma. I'm so thankful that I lived near them in the summer and I got to know her and how kind of a person she was. Good job.
Thank you guys for your thoughts, sharing all those special memories. I'm going to ask Brad and Kim to come forward. They're going to share in a special number this morning. What a day that will be. Stacy Kruselbrink will be playing for that.
Jesus I shall see, when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eyes. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. Day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glory. glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. And I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be.
The family has chosen for scripture today from 2 Corinthians 4, verse 13, through 2 Corinthians 5, verse 5. And so I'm going to read that for you now. Words from the Apostle Paul. It is written, I believed, therefore I have spoken. Since we have that same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak. Because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. All this is for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. And then chapter 5. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling. Because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling. So that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now the one who has fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Pastor Matt Latrell. I have had the privilege of being Van and Wilma's pastor for about 7 years now, and he is, both of them are very special in our lives and our hearts and to the church. And I just want to say today, what a good service this has already been, and memories shared, and things that were brought to light, and the laughter that we could have. I think Wilma would have been absolutely honored by it. Wilma probably would have been a little uncomfortable with that amount of attention, but she would be honored, I think, deep inside of how we are today, on this time, actually have a spirit of joy and a spirit of thankfulness, even in this moment. And it's wonderful that we have so much that we can be thankful for here today. Wonderful to see all of you, family and friends, supporting the family and being here and joining one another and encouraging one another in this time with the good news of Christ. As I mentioned, Wilma, if you knew her, she was not a center of attention kind of a gal, and she might be a little uncomfortable, but I think she would appreciate the spirit of those who just want to say thank you for a life well lived and a model of what it means to be a follower of Christ. We can be thankful for these memories that were shared of Wilma. She was certainly a gift. She was a gift to Van, a wife, a faithful wife, a faithful partner in the good and the bad as he shared, a mother, a grandmother, a great-grandmother, great-grandmother, and she leaves just this legacy behind her of all of you who've been impacted and touched by her life. And we also just think about Wilma and Van both and their shared life together and how every church they've been in, they've blessed. Wilma's family, this church, how they had a hand in the building and the formation of this church, and we certainly have been blessed up in Marcel to have Van and Wilma as a part of our family up there. She served in countless ways, served in any sort of service project. Wilma would be there on the choir, women's ministries, and just the people in our church family, just highly esteem Van and Wilma. I talked to a couple of gals that had years gone by of experience. For example, one of them was Diane Voida, who mentioned that Wilma, memories of Wilma, always perfectly dressed, she said, was one of the things that struck her. Always just had herself together. But she so appreciated her quiet, non-domineering spirit. And Diane even said a lot of times when they're on the women's ministry meetings and they'd be kicking ideas around and they'd have no solution to a problem, then Wilma, just at the end, would quietly say, well, would this possibly work in this situation? And exactly what they needed to hear. It was just exactly the right suggestion for the moment, and they'd all agree and move on. Carolyn Davis mentioned Van and Wilma, too, just saying how much she appreciated your days where you'd have the widow ladies come, and you would host them every September at a meal at their house and put on a great meal and a great time together, just to not allow those ladies to be overlooked within the church. And so we're grateful for that kind of ministry. So Wilma's passing, it causes us, of course, this sadness. But at the same time, we have so much to be grateful for, so much to be thankful for, that she was given this tremendous gift of her life and her service and her ministry to all of you. And not only that, the biggest thing here today is what you've already heard loud and clear. The greatest thing we have to be thankful about is we know where Wilma's at. She's not here with us. But we know where she is. She is not lost. She is with the Lord Jesus Christ in eternal relationship with him. This passage that was just read for us, I think, gives us some gospel hope, crystal clear as to why we can be thankful on this day. And, you know, that passage of Scripture, I think, is always kind of an interesting one. It talks about tents. And, you know, if you sell something and if you make something, you tend to be kind of a promoter of that thing, don't you? Paul was a tent maker by trade, and yet he really didn't say much good about tents. As a matter of fact, he knew what all of us know about camping, which is the best part of camping is going home and getting back into your own bed and saying, why in heaven's name did I ever leave this place and to go live in the woods? Some people are ingenious about their camping trips. They get a house on wheels and they call it camping, but we know the truth. That's not what this is, isn't it? And all of us who have been a time or two in a tent, we can agree with Paul where it says, for while we're still in this tent, we groan. A few years ago, about 5 years ago, I thought it was time to get a nice big tent. I wanted one that I could stand up in. And so I went on Amazon. I found this beautiful tent, pops up in 10 minutes. I could stand up in the thing. 4.5-star reviews. There's always that one grouchy person that puts the review like, this is a piece of junk, don't buy it. But you think, you know, there's always those people in the world. I'm going to ignore it. I'm going to believe the 4.5-star positive reviews. And yet, we got out there, and as a matter of fact, in the first few months, they should have hired me as their sales rep because I was sold on this tent. I was telling everybody, this is a great tent. This is amazing. You should buy one too. But then I got to about the third or fourth time camping, and I realized what the grouchy guy in Amazon was actually dead right about it. It was one of these days, actually very much like today. Rain was coming down. Early on in the process, I was laying there and felt a little splatter of water on me, and I thought, well, you know, maybe somebody sneezed in the tent or something. That surely can't be my tent. But by the next morning, there was more rain leaking through that rain fly than in my shower head, I can tell you. And I groaned in that tent. I understood what Paul was saying. But of course, Paul's not talking about tents that you take camping. What Paul's talking about is this earthly body. It's a metaphor. And as eternal beings, all of us are either going to spend eternity with Christ or eternity apart from God, but as eternal beings, all of us have our eternal personhood housed in these earthly containers, these tents, and our bodies at times can be a lot like an old leaky tent, can't they? Now, in context, Paul here is speaking about actually his own apostolic ministry, his work as an apostle, sharing the gospel throughout the Roman Empire. And the apostle Paul, I imagine when he walked into the city of Corinth for the first time, he looked pretty haggard, I bet. He tells a little later in 2 Corinthians the kind of things he went through. It says, countless beatings, often near death. 5 times I received the hands of the Jew, from the hands of the Jews, 40 lashes, less one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was pelted with stones. 3 times I was shipwrecked, a night and a day on the drift on the sea. Many a sleepless night in hunger and thirst, often without food, in cold exposure. And apart from other things, there's the daily pressure on me for the anxiety for all of the churches. So I imagine when the Apostle Paul walked into Corinth, he didn't look bright and fresh and ready for ministry. He probably looked like he had seen a lot of tough days. And everybody who was there and saw him walk in and said, and this guy is from God? This guy is the one who has this eternal gospel that he's going to share with us? He doesn't look like much. And he said there a little earlier in that passage that was read for us, he says, we're like people that contain this message of Christ in jars of clay, cracked pots, so to speak, frail. And you know, that may not be that you're an apostle. You're not an apostle, let me tell you that. But you do have a message of the gospel. And that message of the gospel and that eternal life that you have, if you have a relationship with him, is an incredible thing, but it's housed in such a frail, earthly tent. And you know, I don't care who you are. You feel the groan, don't you, in your life? I'm 43 years old. I have an elder at church who helpfully informed me when I turned 40. He said, Matt, my doctor told me years ago, before 40, you're bulletproof. After that, everything falls apart. So far, he's been 100% right. That's the way it's going. And even as Christians, you know, we have the strength and the presence and the relationship with God where we walk through tough things, but you know what we don't get is insulated from all of those things, all of the groaning that takes place in our earthly tent. And you know, Wilma, certainly she was somebody that in the last years of her earthly journey here, she had a lot of things to groan. And all of you did as well. The memory loss. The memory is the thing that kind of ties our lives together, that we have that shared memory of something in the past that gives us that connection. And when you lose that, that is a hard thing to lose. Hard, hard thing to lose. And she had health issues, and she had a process by which this was progressing in her body, and it was a slow and progressive process, and that groaning came to all of you guys in the process as you saw and witnessed that happening. But that's not where we want to focus. That was hard to see, but you know what? Even in the moments of this, we can have reason, that we can have joy and even praise the Lord. There's 2 reasons from this passage, and the first one is that God transformed Wilma, her groaning, into glory. It says in verse 16, so we don't lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. As Christians, we walk that by faith. We don't always see it. Outwardly, we're wasting away, but inwardly, when we have that relationship with Christ, that connection with him, that salvation from him, we are being renewed day by day. The good work of salvation that God started in Wilma's life even continued in the days of her Alzheimer's and her struggle with memory because God never let her go. I'm told in South Africa there's a kind of a tree that grows on a barren flank of rock without roots, scarcely able to penetrate into the ground, but it's called a cow tree. And the reason it's called that is because from the outward signs of it, it actually looks like it maybe is even not alive anymore. It seems pretty rough to the eyes. And yet when you pierce that tree, there is a nourishing, sweet milk that immediately flows out of it when it's there. And the tree's looks are deceiving. That's how it is with a Christian. As we age, outwardly it seems like we're decaying, we're wasting away, but inwardly there is a life that comes from God's Spirit that is inside of us, that continues to be renewed by God's Spirit day in and day out, and we walk with the Lord. With Wilma, what do we have? This mortality was swallowed up by life. That's what it said in verses 4 and 5. For while we're still in this tent, we groan, being burdened. Not that we would be unclothed, but that we would be further clothed, so that what is mortal would be swallowed up by life. And he who has prepared us this very thing is God, who has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. And so Wilma is no longer with us anymore, but as I said, she's not lost. And as was mentioned already, what a glorious thought that Wilma is with the Lord Jesus Christ, that she is in heaven, that she, all of the memory loss that she had is now gone. All of the things that ailed her in this life are forever forgotten, and that she has this incredible life. That's something to praise the Lord for. The other thing, though, that we can praise the Lord for, God transforms our groaning into growth. It's easy to misunderstand this passage and just say, well, life is really bad, and then someday we'll die, and we'll go to heaven, and it'll all be over. Part of that's true. But he says something else here in verse 17. He says, for this light and momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. That word preparing, producing, other translations say. Can even the Greek word behind it can even refer to the workout that an athlete would do to prepare for an athletic event. It's saying here that the sufferings that God, through his providence, when he allows it to touch our lives, that he has purposeful intent and he's going to use it for our good and for his glory and to grow us and to train us. And you know what? I have seen that happen. Van shared how he was transformed into a caregiver. It changed him in the process to be more shaped into the image of Jesus Christ. What a glorious thing. Hasn't it done that for all of you? It shaped you a little bit more. Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be. And you know what? Our treasure of Wilma is now in heaven. It draws us that direction. Part of the joy, part of the gift that God has given us has gone on ahead of us. It draws us to a more eternal perspective. And in the process, it also has taught, I think, a lot of you in the family what self-sacrificial love looks like. It was mentioned here how Wilma was a self-sacrificial lover of all of you. And there came a point in her life when it turned and you had to be the self-sacrificial giver and lover to her, to give her. I've seen it in Van. I've seen him transition to from a companion and a fellow into a caregiver and one that was giving himself for her on a daily basis in spite of the old things he struggled with. And God gave him that strength. I've seen it in you girls as you've had to make decisions and take turns caregiving and driving and figuring out doctor's appointments and all of those things you have learned in all of this. And I just wanted to say that because Romans 13 says that we are to give honor where honor is due. And you know what? For all of you in the family, honor is due to you. The way you cared for Wilma, it was just a beautiful thing. And I know you always look back and think, I could have done this better, I should have done. Just say from outside perspective, watching on, you've done a beautiful gift to Wilma. And thank you, and you deserve to be honored. And so God also will keep transforming, even this next season where you're going to miss and you're going to have some different journeys. God hasn't left you now. If you keep your eyes on those things that are unseen, the eternal, rather than what is seen, he will continue to use it for your growth. And I think for that, we can praise God here today as well. We can praise God today because he transforms our groans both into glory and into growth. Before I quit, though, I just want to say one other thing. Verse 17 says, this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. If you read that wrong, you might get the impression that it's almost trivializing the pain of this moment. It's light and momentary. But I don't think it probably, for most people, feels light and momentary in this moment. It actually probably feels pretty heavy, pretty hard. But what he's asking us to do is to see this through the eyes of faith. You already know a little bit of that experience if you look back in your own life. Think back 20, 30, 40, 50 years in your own life and the things that seemed so heavy at those moments. When you were a kid in high school and you didn't make the basketball team, the football team, or something like that, it felt crushing because that was crushing for you in that moment. Or if, like me, had a girlfriend that nearly broke up with her, I ended up marrying her, but at the time, it felt, this near breakup felt like an emotional free-for-all. Receiving a doctor's bills later on in our life when we didn't have any health insurance to pay for it. I saw the biggest bill I've ever seen in my life and wondering, how is this ever going to get paid? or having a newborn like we did, who didn't seem to sleep more than 2 to 3 hours for the first 3 to 6 months of his life. All of that at the time seemed heavy, but now 20 years from now, doesn't seem that heavy. When you see life and you see it in the perspective of eternity, that's where we're able to see this moment as light and momentary. One day we'll see Wilma face to face again in the presence of God. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we'll have no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. And it's then that we will really recognize how light and momentary all of this was in light of the glory that God has for us in Christ Jesus. Apostle Paul said, "For I consider the present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that is being revealed to us." So in this day, as an act of faith, let's praise God. Let's praise God that if we keep our faith in Jesus Christ, that he will transform all of our groans into glory and also into growth right now. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you've given us hope in the gospel. Wilma, of course, Lord, we know from your word that the way in which we're saved, and we know that the reason that Wilma is with you right now is not because Wilma earned it, although she was a wonderful, wonderful person. It's purely by your grace. She knew you. She received the free gift of salvation that you atoned for her sins upon the cross. And I pray and ask, Lord, just today that as we continue to reflect and we're going to sit around and we're going to eat some food together and we're going to share some more stories and some more time, I pray, Lord, that in the midst of those conversations that we would also be able to just encourage one another with the hope that only the gospel can bring. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We are going to sing a song in our hymnals. It'll be number 774, but if you want to look on the screen, it'll be on there as well. Maybe for this one, just go ahead and stay seated before the benediction. So just stay seated for this one. 774. to go for it? Okay. We're debating on whether or not to go out to the cemetery at this time, so that is what we're going to do, and we're going to brave it. Now, all of you may not want to go out there or able to with the weather, so you're welcome to stay here and have a seat, and the family will go out to the cemetery, and we'll be back in just a few minutes after that. But why don't you stand as I just say a benediction to us here at this point in the service. Now may the Lord Jesus be with you, for he came to bind up the brokenhearted, to comfort all who mourn, and to provide for those who grieve. He has promised to grant you a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, and the garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. Amen.
As we plan to depart, we're going to sing a triumphal hymn as we leave. Not that they've not been triumphal, but what we have learned today, what we have been able to celebrate is the victory that we have in Jesus. And so as we prepare to leave this place, let's sing together 353, Victory in Jesus.
Thank you.
Amen. Well, there is a little change of plan. There's not going to be the interment directly after the service. As you can see, it is raining sideways outside. Praise the Lord. And so instead, we would just like, if you would just exit here from the sanctuary, and then we're going to have a meal together. And so please stick around and fellowship with the family. It means so much to them. And so thank you for coming today.